you're not in love.
We just want to give you thanks and praise for being that God to us. We thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy. And we thank you that you are the one who conquers. You are the one who is faithful. You are the one who walks through us, through all the stages of this life. And we just worship you here tonight. We thank you for this opportunity to worship you. And we pray that we would do so both in spirit and in truth. The truth of who you are, the truth of your word, the truth of your story written in our lives would merge with the spirit that you have sent to dwell within us, and that you would inhabit our hearts in this place to your glory and to your honor. Lord, we thank you for being the king of our hearts. We thank you for being ruler of our destinies and the keeper of our days. We thank you for the privilege of worship. Lord, let nothing distract us from being in your presence, as we pray all these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Lord, you are the maker of my life.
shaper of my soul, master and creator, the healer and sustainer. I will put my trust in you alone. Teach me to be faithful to confess, and in this way my spirit daily. You have loved me greatly, moving them as far as east from west. So let me be open, and let me be humble. Let me find the joy of my salvation in your cross. And let me be broken whenever I stumble.
Satan tempts me to despair, tells me of the guilt within, the word I look at and see him now, who made and mended my sin. Because a sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free, for God the just is satisfied to look on him and on me, to look on him and on me. Hold him there, the risen one, my perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood, my life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior. Christ my Savior and my God. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood, my life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior. My Savior, my
God. Please just join me in a word of prayer. Father God, we just want to come before you right now as we, with great intention, turn toward your word. And we ask, Father, that you would speak to our hearts. Lord, that you would use this time to bring glory and honor to the name of Jesus, that he would be exalted in our hearts and in our lives and in our community and in our world, Lord, because you desire to change us, and to be in your presence is to change. And so, Lord, we come to you during this time with open hearts, with open minds, and we say, Lord, speak, for your servants are listening. We pray these things and ask these things all in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Well, my commendations to you all, having announced last week that I was going to do one more week of philosophy, that you actually came back. So that's a great blessing and encouragement. We are going to just finish up something that we started last week, but this is a message that will stand on its own, but if you want more in terms of background, you should check out last week's message on the church website, and you will see kind of where this message is springing off from. It really comes from this section of sermons that I've collected called Power Words, pulling a word out of Scripture that God has used to just show me a lot of things about who He is and who I am in the world that He's put us in. And this message today and the message last week are rooted in Colossians chapter 2, verse 8. And it's a passage where Paul is writing to the church in Colossae, and he says, "See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the basic principles of this world rather than on Christ." And it's really that word philosophy. And I know for many of us, the last time we took a class in philosophy was a long, long time ago, if ever. And I get that, but when Paul writes that we are to see to it, or be on our guard, or be watchful against anyone taking us captive or hostage against our will through something Paul identifies as hollow and deceptive philosophy,
If we don't take the time to consider what that might be, if we don't even heed the words of, it wasn't a Christian, it was B.C. when Socrates lived and did his philosophizing, but saying the unexamined life is not worth living, if we don't actually step back as Christians and examine, well, what are the philosophies that we're immersed in day in and day out, how can we be on guard? How can we be watchful? If these philosophies are deceptive, how do we know we're not being taken in if we're not spending any time or any amount of energy trying to figure out what they are? So today I'm going to continue this message to talk about this word philosophy to help us, really my desire in these two messages, to help us grasp that there are philosophies that we're not even aware of, that we live by and that the people around us live by, and the decisions that we make and the things that we do are firmly rooted in them. There's a myth that exists, and I want to talk about this very common myth. It's very important that we understand this myth, okay? This is how most people explain and justify their belief in this myth that we're going to talk about. People say this, maybe you've heard somebody say this. You know what, all I ever hear from religious people is arguments over who's right and who's wrong, why they're right and why they're wrong. And I'm so tired of all the fighting, I choose not to believe in any of it. My position is, I don't believe in anything, so just leave me alone. So the myth, if we're actually to put words to it, the myth is this. Everyone else might live their lives according to a set of ideological principles that are rooted in a worldview, but not me. Not me. Everyone else might live this way, but not me. Everyone else might have these convictions, but not me. In 2019, the Pew Research Foundation found that two-thirds, or 65%, of Americans describe themselves as Christians. By the way, that was down from 77% down back in 2009. The most interesting thing about the Pew research, though, to me, was what they found in the number of Americans who consider themselves of no religious group whatsoever. They call themselves the nuns, okay? Now, we have to be careful with that, those of us that grew up in Catholic Church. These aren't the N-U-N's, okay? These are the N-O-N-E's, nuns. So when it comes to surveys, they say, are you this, are you that, are you this, are you that? They say, I'm none, N-O-N-E, okay? I'm none of the above. I'm not this religion, I'm not that religion, I don't believe in this, I don't believe in that, I don't believe in these values, I don't believe in those values. And the shocking thing that the Pew research showed us was that the nuns had risen to 26%, up from 17% just a decade before. A 10% growth, it's the largest growing denomination in America today, is this group called the nuns, N-O-N-E-S. There's actually a book written by James Emery White, the former president of Gordon Conwell, called The Rise of the Nuns. And in a desperate plea to believe the myth, the so-called nuns claim to adhere to no religious ideas or convictions whatsoever. Unfortunately, the claim to reject truth claims about God or about existence or about eternity is in itself a religious idea and conviction. And this is what I want to show you. Before we launch into philosophy, I want to talk religion just for one quick minute here. This is the dictionary definition, not my definition, not even a Bible dictionary. Dictionary, I think it's dictionary.com. Yeah, dictionary.com definition of what a religion actually is. This is so important. Listen to this definition. A religion is a fundamental set of beliefs and practices generally agreed upon by a group of people. These set of beliefs concerns the cause, nature, and purpose of the universe and involve devotional and ritual observances. They also often contain a moral code governing the conduct of human affairs. See, we think of religion and we think, do you go to this church or that temple or that mosque? That's not what the dictionary definition of a religion is. The dictionary definition of a religion is anyone who has a set of beliefs and practices that's held by a group of people. And that system of belief tends to be centered around concerning the cause and the nature and the purpose of life itself. Devotional and ritual observances just means they do things in common. They look alike in what they do, in the way that they live their lives. And they have a moral code. That moral code might be complete immorality to you and me, but it's a moral code nonetheless. This is the point I want to get across. The loudest, angriest atheist on the planet is a deeply religious person. We need to understand this. The woman who has no use for the Bible or for the things of God or those who preach God's word because she's become an enlightened intellectual and has multiple degrees on her wall is a deeply religious individual. The guy who has no time for church or the things of God because the worship of sports seems to have adequately fulfilled that hole in his life is a deeply religious person. They just go to different places to express their worship. The expression of their worship just looks different. But we are created by a God to be individuals designed to worship something or someone. Many nuns, N-O-N-E-S, believe they're off the hook. They're not. There's not a human being walking the planet whose life is not built upon a fundamental set of beliefs and practices concerning the cause, nature, and purpose of the universe, and who practice ritual observances and follow some kind of moral code. I talked about a few examples of philosophies last week, and I want to just share with you, as I've gone through some of these different philosophical views, and there's a big chart on the bulletin board back there. You can look at it. I had a handout last week, and you can look at all these different isms, you know, theism or deism or existentialism or nihilism, or you can look at Islam. You can look at pantheism or naturalism. It doesn't matter what the ism is. You can look into it. And you can see all these categories, but you know what? These aren't things that people sign up for and say, yep, this is my ism, give me all of these. People can shift and they mix around and they sort of dabble and they don't really know where they stand, so they're inconsistent and sometimes they're over here and sometimes they're over there. But there's one very extreme example that when you start with theism, there is a God. And God is known to us as Father, Son, and Spirit as revealed in Genesis 1, 2, and 3. And God shows us who He is. And God loves us. And He has a story that He's writing through human history. And it's the story of our redemption. That's theism. Then you can move to deism where, yeah, there's a God, but He's distant and He doesn't really interact with us. And you can go from deism to naturalism and say, yeah, I don't see God, and if I can't see it, hear it, smell it, taste it, or feel it, if it's not part of my five senses, I believe in science, I believe in reason, and I don't see God. Naturalism is where you see atheism start to move from deism to a disbelief in there being a God. And you just keep going down that track, and eventually you can get to a place of nihilism. This is another ism. I'm not going to spend much time on this one, but what nihilism is it's a denial of any philosophy or worldview, a denial of the possibility of knowledge, and even the reality of existence. Do you see where the ball is picking up speed as it goes downhill from belief in God to not sure if there's a God? If He is, He's distant and uninvolved, to I believe in science, to eventually, you know what? I'm done. I'm checking out. Nihilism is really just atheism lived to its logical conclusion. What's the point? Why does it matter? If science is all that's true, and it tells us we live in a mechanical universe that is cold and indifferent toward us, then it stands to reason that human beings are conscious machines without the ability to affect their own destiny or do anything significant. Therefore, human beings, as valuable beings, are dead. This is where the philosopher Nietzsche came up with his God is dead. God is dead. And you know what? You can back up to even supposedly the greatest, the most profound minds in scientific history, and you can look at people, the naturalist Charles Darwin. Okay, you know that name, right? Charles Darwin and his studies in the Galapagos Islands and his theories about natural selection and whatnot. You want to hear one of the quotes you don't hear very often attributed to Charles Darwin. Listen to something Darwin wrote in the last couple of years of his life. His words: "The horrid doubt always arises whether the convictions of man's mind, which has developed from the mind of lower animals, are of any value or at all trustworthy. Would anyone trust the conviction of a monkey's mind?" Uh-oh. Maybe the greatest scientific minds aren't enough. So what happens when we raise our kids to place their faith in science alone and tell them rational thought is the only God worth worshiping? Well, what happens when our scientific theories get replaced, which is what they're designed to be? That's why they're called theories. What happens when you've built your life on that? Where does that leave you but in a pointless existence? Nihilism. What's the point? When you see on the news an 80-year-old woman who's just had her purse snatched and a person kicking that woman while she's on the ground, and you think to yourself, what is going on? What is going on is that person is living out their religious convictions. And theirs just happens to be, what's the point? What is the point? And for all of our scientific, rational thought, somehow we can't overcome the reality that for some reason, suicide has grown by 35% over the past two decades. But wait a sec, I thought we were becoming enlightened. I thought we were moving towards utopia. People are taking their lives 35% more today than just two decades ago? That's what the statistics tell us. For all of our medical know-how, we've concluded that it's better to medicate a kid's feelings away than to teach them how to feel them. And here's the point, one of the things I really hope you've taken away from these two messages. Philosophical convictions are not reserved for stuffy university professors. From the high church theism of the Middle Ages to Eastern pantheistic beliefs and practices of the East, to the rise of humanism throughout the Renaissance, to the elevation of science and naturalism and atheism, strains of philosophical thought have dominated certain eras of history in certain corners of the globe. You have not been immune. So I want to finish this series by talking about this last one. And I saved this one for last because I believe this is the religion of the day you and I live in. I believe postmodernism is the religion that our world has adopted and settled on more than any other. Now, I disclaimer, you read 12 books on postmodernism, you'll come away with 12 different understandings as to what it is. They're still fighting about it, okay? So I'm not here to try to solve that riddle for you at all. I do think it's very important for you to understand at least what it is. Anytime the word post is in front of something, it just means after, okay? So postmodernism is just saying after modernism. So very quickly, what in the world is modernism if we're moving past it, okay? I don't know what modernism is, so I really don't know what postmodernism is. Let me give you three quick broad brushstrokes as to what modernism is. Modernism is what we've all kind of been steeped in, post-World War I generation, saying, you know what, this is what this is the way the world works. Reason and science provide accurate, objective, reliable foundations for knowledge. That's where our trust needs to be. Morality, modernists believe, is something we can define. Our reason will bring us to understand what true morality is and what good is and what bad is, and we will eventually all agree to it once reason brings us to that conclusion. That's what modernists say. A modernist believes that there is an overarching story, what they call a meta-narrative, kind of a fancy word, but there's a story, modernists would say, that binds us all together. And many modernists would say that story is science. Oh, that story is reason, or thought, or intellectualism, or whatever. But there is a story that we all have in common, okay? Again, these are just three principles. I could list about 10 others, but postmodernism, just to give you a flavor for what postmodernism is a world of thought, an ideology that says reason and science are ideologies which are simply myths created by man. We can't put our faith and trust in that because they're things that are man-created, and if they're man-created, they're relative. Okay, big word in postmodernism, relative. In other words, it may be true there, doesn't mean it's true here. Postmodernists believe that morality itself is relative. Situational ethics. Depends who you are, depends on what your background was, depends on, whatever. Whatever the situation calls for. How does a person on television who has a microphone in front of them, who's carrying a 60-inch flat screen on their back, running out of a store, decides to give an interview and says, well, what are you doing? Well, I deserve this. Okay. Why? Well, you believe something is true for you. It may not be true for the other person, but you're living out your truth. Postmodernists would also say there is no universally binding meta-narrative. Any story but one's own story is oppressive. If I try to export my story on you, I am oppressing you. Do you hear the language of our day? They are buying into this hook, line, and sinker. There is no story that we are all under. You're living your story, I'm living my story. You're living your truth, I'm living my truth. Don't ever let your story intersect with my story. You have your morality, good for you. Don't let it intersect with my morality. Reason and science, you can put your faith in that if you want to. And this is interesting, because this is where postmodernism is butting heads with modernism more than anything else, I believe, and even contradicting itself. Let me tell you what I mean by that. Let's just talk about climate change. I'm not getting into politics here. I'm getting into the stories that our culture is telling, okay? Climate change. The climate is changing. We're all going to either freeze or burn or whatever. People are telling us we have 10 years left or 12 years left. I lost track of the count, what number we're on, but it's a short time, okay? The planet's going to implode or explode or whatever, okay? Because the planet is coming to an end. Okay, that's the theory that's put forward. And what do they say? Look to the science. Don't ignore the science. You have to follow the science. There are scientific computer models of what's happening. You need to follow the science. Okay. Different situation. Gender fluidity. People arguing that you can be born with this set of parts and pieces, and that's what determines what your gender is. And scientists can look at your DNA and determine you either have an XX or you have an XY, and that is what your gender is. But all of a sudden, in our day and age, they're saying, no, that's not it. Culture forms your gender. And then you say, excuse me, I'm looking to the science. Don't you look at the science. What do you do? Do you see? It's just clashing, and it doesn't even make sense with itself. Ignore the science. But I thought I was supposed to follow the science. Follow the science over here. Don't follow the science over there. What do you do? Truth to the postmodern mind is your story, your experience, your gut feeling. It's all about story. It's all about narrative. And this is the words they love to talk about. Everything's about, let's have a dialogue, let's have a conversation, let me hear your story, you can hear my story, and that's what's going to fix the world. You telling your story, and you hearing my story, and we'll walk away with two totally disparate stories, and somehow we'll live better. I mean, how about this quote? Never be concerned about proving truth. You only need to be concerned with living it and being it. Oh, it sounds so nice. The only truth that can be had is your own personal truth. That's why story is so important and why everyone is so obsessed with this word narrative. I want to read you a quote that absolutely took my breath away from the book that I mentioned last week, James Sire's Universe Next Door. I want you to hear how he talks about this particular idea of story as the highway or the access point to understanding truth. Sire writes this, "If then claims to truth are not seen as the way things really are, if all we have are humanly constructed stories, your story, my story, their story, if that's all we have that we believe and we tell," he says, "total anarchy is not the result. It's not necessarily the result." In other words, we can have different stories and not have total anarchy in the streets. And I read that and I thought, whew, good. This postmodern fixation on individual stories doesn't have to result in the total breakdown of our world. And then he writes the word but. And then he wrote a sentence that I haven't been able to get out of my head or my heart for about a month and a half now. He says, "But communities begin to fall apart when different people within them believe substantially different stories." This is our world. This is what we're seeing played out day after day after day. That's why a group of people wanted to wear red and shut down the Bourne Bridge a couple days ago. The stories have gotten so different and so radical in their worldviews and their beliefs. Communities begin to fall apart. He wrote this, by the way, in 1976. 1976. All right. We're going to end on the note where we need to end. We're going to end with Scripture here. What does Scripture have to say about all this? What does Scripture have to say to both the modernist mindset that argues that objective truth is attainable only through science, and the postmodern mindset argues, saying that the only truth that matters is your own personal version of it? Where do we land? Here's where we land. Jesus prayed for you and for me in John chapter 17. Does that thought ever astound you? Jesus prayed for you and for me in John chapter 17. In verses 16 and 17 of that passage, Jesus prayed these words. "They are not of the world." He's talking to his Father about you and me, and he's saying, this group of people, they are not of this world, even as I am not of it. And then Jesus said, "Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth." To sanctify means to set apart, to pull away from, and to use for a holy purpose. And what he's saying here is, Jesus is praying to his Father, and he's saying, listen, those that stand up to follow you, God, the Father, in what I'm about to do on the cross and in the power of the Holy Spirit that dwells within them, they're not going to be of this world anymore, even as I'm not of it. Jesus is saying, we're going to be walking through this world just like he was. And then he prays this beautiful prayer. Sanctify them, God. Father, set them apart for holy purposes, for holy use. Sanctify them by the truth. And then he follows it and says, your word is truth. Not your story, not my story, not their story. His. His word is the truth. That's where we land. What about the modernist who argues that morality can be defined through human reason, and or the postmodern person who argues in favor of moral relativism? Whatever the situation calls for, or however you feel in any particular moment, that's true morality to you. I love the closing words of the Old Testament book of Ecclesiastes. What is morality? In his search for wisdom, Solomon concludes this. Now all has been heard. I love that. Now all has been heard, and here is the conclusion of the matter. Whatever he's about to say next is pretty important. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every deed into judgment, including every hidden thing, whether it is good or evil. You can live your life God has given all of us free will, and if you want to live your life and saying your morality is their morality, is his morality, is her morality, and they're all different, you can do whatever you want, understand something. That's your worldview. Understand something else. It's not mine. I'm going to fear God. I'm going to keep his commandments because I believe that he is watching every deed, not as some ogre in the sky with a club ready to beat me when I step out of line, but as a gracious father waiting for his wayward son to come home. This is my God. Do you see what Scripture is continually calling us to when it comes to engaging with the philosophical convictions of the world? It's always doing the same thing. It's not a continual challenge to grapple in philosophical debate. And if you've been sitting here for these two messages and you go, you know what, maybe I need to get a grasp of this so I'm better at arguing philosophy, that's not what Scripture, I believe, is challenging us to do. If that's the track that God has you on, I praise God for guys like Ravi Zacharias, who's home with the Lord now, and guys like C.S. Lewis, who's with the Lord as well, and people that just had these incredible minds for understanding these complex understandings of who God is and could debate on a philosophical level. But I don't see Scripture calling us to do that. It's not a continual challenge to grapple in philosophical debate with other people. It's not even to corner people into their contradictory logic. No. Scripture doesn't embolden us to go down into the muck and into the mire of philosophical debate. Its continual challenge and plea to us is to rise above. To have our eyes fixed above. As a matter of fact, in that same book of Colossians, in the next chapter, it says, fix your eyes on things above, not on earthly things. Fix your eyes above. Set your hearts on things above. To look above, to raise our focus higher, to transcend even time, that we might focus on matters of eternity. What did the Apostle Paul in Corinth? Corinth, just really quick, Corinth was a place that loved all Greek thought and culture and took it to the max. They had Greek temples there, they had philosophers, anything that was Greek, Corinth loved and did it to the max. So when it came to worldviews, Corinth was an expert at it. And Paul went to Corinth and he faced all these different challenges and issues and trying to plant a church in this place, in this pagan place, these places where there were temple prostitutes and shrines to all these small g gods and people arguing ridiculous points of philosophy that didn't matter. How did Paul come? You know, Paul could argue philosophy. If you doubt that even for a moment, read the book of Romans sometime. I mean, just sit down and try to plow through Romans, right? Paul could grapple with the best of them. Paul was unbelievable. Not only that, on his own and with the training that he had, you fuse that with inspiration by the Holy Spirit, watch out. That's the book of Romans. But Paul goes to this place called Corinth, and they are steeped in Greek culture and in Greek philosophy. How does Paul approach such a place? Does he corner people and argue philosophy with them and beat them into submission intellectually? Well, Paul's own words. Guys, I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And if you're sitting there going, oh wait, isn't that as kind of a simplistic way out? Not to Paul. That was everything. That was everything. Paul was saying, I didn't come there to engage in philosophical debates with people. I came and I wanted them to know one thing and one thing only. I want them to know who this Jesus was, and I want them to know that this Jesus was crucified for them. Remember the verse I shared with you a few weeks ago from Philippians, my life verse, Philippians 3:10. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and share in the fellowship of his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. I want to know him. I want to exude him. I want him to consume me and my thoughts and my worldview. I want to rise above these petty debates of this world that we live in. Paul could have done it if he wanted to, but he didn't. he rose above and told them the story of the love of God demonstrated in the crucified Jesus. Here's the exciting thing about the world we live in today. 10, 15, 20, 30 years ago, you could say something like that and be laughed off the corner, you know, laughed off the street corner. That's the dumbest thing I've ever heard of. Jesus Christ and him crucified. And people would literally laugh in your face for saying that. Here's the positive thing from an evangelism standpoint today. The philosophies of the world that they are preaching to each other are so contradictory and stupid on their own face. This couldn't sound any dumber than the stuff they're throwing out now. This couldn't sound any more foreign. If we come to it and understand, listen, you come from a religious conviction. You're coming from a worldview, and I'm not here to debate you. I'm here to love you. I will even listen to you, as painful as that might be sometimes. I will listen to you. But at the end of the day, you need to know something. I believe in this Jesus, and I believe he was crucified for your sin and for mine. And that's where I stand. That's where I'm anchored. That's where my hope is. That's what I'm holding on to in this world, is the hope of Jesus Christ. I'm going to close this message, and I'm going to read a section of Scripture to you. It's not going to be on the screen. I'd like you to just close your eyes if it helps you hear it. I want you to hear Paul's own description of this Jesus from the same book that we've been in, the book of Colossians. We've been in Colossians 2, which talks about a hollow and deceptive philosophy, but I want to back up a chapter, and I want you to hear the words Paul uses to describe this Jesus. It's my favorite description outside of John chapter 1 in the Bible. I love the way Paul describes Jesus in Colossians 1, starting at verse 15. I'm just going to read these four verses. This is how Paul sees this Jesus. He couldn't stop talking about. Paul writes, Jesus is the image of the invisible God. He is the firstborn over all of creation. For by this Jesus, all things were created. Things in heaven and on earth, things that are visible, things that are invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by Jesus and for Jesus. Jesus is before all things, and in Jesus, all things hold together. And Jesus is the head of the body, the church. Jesus is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything, Jesus might have the supremacy. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it truly is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Father, as this world and maybe even within our own homes, there is call to debate and call to just jump down into the mud of, do you take this position? Do you take that position? Do you vote this way? Do you vote that way? May the supremacy of Christ rule in our hearts. May the supremacy of Christ rule in our speech. May the supremacy of Christ rule in our actions. Lord, help us to rise above, to love people with the heart of Christ, to listen to people with the ears of Christ, to see people with the eyes of Christ. That in all things, Jesus Christ might have the supremacy. We pray in his name.
Christ, my hope is
how we live.
No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus completes my debt.
Sing it, church.
Grace.